and welcome to A Film I Love. I'm Jenny, I'm one of the trustees of the Cambridge Film Trust, and it's my absolute pleasure to welcome the director, Sarah Gavron, to A Film I Love. Sarah, welcome. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
Your films are just, Brick Lane, Suffragette, most recently Rocks, which was the opening film of the 2019 Cambridge Film Festival. Such a brilliant body of work, particularly when it comes to representing interesting layered female characters on screen. And so with in association with that, your choice, Girlhood by Céline Sciamma, can you, just to start, can you tell us why did you pick this film as your film, the film you love?
Well, I picked it because it was one of a series of films that came out of European cinema that massively inspired me. Because it was, one, it was a female director, Céline Sciamma, who's gone on to, you know, make Portrait of a Lady and had made wonderful films before, like Tomboy and Water Lilies. And also because it was a world that we don't often see on our screens. It focuses on female friendship. It's a cast of young Black women who aren't normally the centre of narratives. And it was part of a series of films that really inspired Rocks. You know, when we were looking at what to make, we wanted to make a film about young people, and we were like, where are they? And oddly, they weren't much in British cinema, I mean, here and there, but they were more in European cinema. So we went to films like Girlhood, along with Mustang and Divines and other wonderful films, and really looked to it as a sort of a film that paved the way for us in some ways.
You're right, it is one about friendship and the kind of the coming of age story, but it's groups of young women who you don't often see represented. But within Girlhood, there is one leading character, Marianne Vick. Can you tell us a bit about her character and her sort of development as the film progresses?
Yeah, she's a very complex protagonist. You know, you meet her first. You actually have this wonderful opening scene. I don't want to spoil it for anyone who's about to watch it. Of them at a football game, you know, all armoured up, these girls, you don't realise they're girls. Then she goes home and you see her in her domestic environment as a carer for her younger siblings. Her mum works cleaning in a hotel. And then you see that she goes to school and she's at a point where the school isn't going to support her to go to high school, although she wants to. And she's, you know, having this sort of devastating realization that she's kind of being chucked out. And at that moment, she meets a group of girls who are looking for another member to join their gang. And they become her friends in this kind of adverse situation. And, you know, there's moments of great highs and great lows. And it's a very, very difficult journey she goes on. And you sort of see her sexual awakening and you see her get involved in drug dealing and all sorts of dark moments. But through it all, you really, really understand each of her decisions, even if they're very, very flawed. And at the end, you see a woman with resolve. I mean, it's a very poignant ending, and you don't know what's going to happen to her. It doesn't tell you one way or another, but there's something about it that leaves you hopeful in a tiny way.
That's interesting. I was going to ask if you thought it was a hopeful film, because my recollections of first watching it aren't that, but actually revisiting the final scene, there does, as you say, there feels like there is that modicum of hope. How does the film play with notions of identity and feminine identity?
Yeah, so that's also dealt with, you know, in a very nuanced way. And I think the director's a master of that. And you know, she wrote the screenplay, and you see her not just as a girl, you see her as in this caring capacity. You also see her as someone when she's sort of forced to use her sexuality, when she doesn't have to be on, when she's not working, she binds her breasts, she dresses in baggy clothes, she cuts her hair short. So she's, you know, claiming what might traditionally be called a masculine identity at those moments and finding kind of safety in that in some ways. And she's very tough and she fights and she does a lot of things that we traditionally associate with boys. So she occupies both, and that's really intriguing.
It's interesting you say that about the fighting, because I was in an interview with Céline Sciamma talking about the portrayal of anger and violence in the film, and she said she wanted to do something different from the typical good, you know, evil and good fighting. She wanted to show that, and I quote, how a fight can be a struggle, violence can be political for women, it can be empowering and shouldn't be looked at as hysterical. How do you think she captures that in Girlhood? And I suppose that relates when it comes to your work with Suffragette, that feels like such a great parallel there.
Yeah, well, the fight scene is a pivotal moment. There are two fights, big fight scenes in Girlhood, and they are pivotal. And in a way that you see the protagonist gain, be empowered by the fact that she wins the second fight. And it's a huge moment for her, and her status in the group and in her community goes up. So there is a way in which it works in the way that you described. And it's so interesting to hear Céline Sciamma describe it as that. I mean, when I was working on Rocks, which was very much a collaboration and was fed into by so many stories that came from the girls themselves and came from the writer Teresa Rococo and Claire Wilson, and Teresa particularly, who knew that world so well, having grown up in Hackney and having lived amongst those communities and also worked with them. And, you know, fighting was something that those girls did occasionally, and we do depict that in one moment in the film. And it was striking how when we filmed it, how easy it was for them to play that role. You know, they knew it, they knew how to fight, they knew how to be aggressive. It wasn't, it was in their language, it was in their kind of wheelhouse, which was interesting to me because it wasn't something I could have done as a young teenager. I wouldn't have known how to adopt that persona.
I love how I've been listening to various interviews with you talking about the making of Rocks, and you always refer back to collaboration and just the team that you had both, you know, on, you know, in front of and behind the camera. And with regards to Girlhood, the parallels of the casting and how you found these brilliant girls, young women who hadn't acted before. Can you tell us a bit about that, about how it was for Rocks?
Yeah, so I was reading actually about the Girlhood casting, and I know that they did what, you know, is called street casting, where you're not going to drama schools, you're not going to the traditional routes and finding actors who have done it before, you're finding people who haven't and working with them. And I think they described it as taking 4 months. Well, for us, it took over a year. It took, you know, a year and a half, really, because we began with this process of sitting in schools. Lucy Pardy, who was the casting director, but also a researcher, and Lucy's worked with Andrew Arnold, and she's done a lot of street casting and worked, you know, knows how to go into communities, to talk to people, to find out if they're interested, to invite them to workshops. She knows that you're playing the long game. You can't just meet someone once and they're, you know, they don't trust you, you don't know them. It's a long, long process. So we went into these schools, and it was partly at that point about finding stories and working out who wanted to come on that journey with us. But then we invited a number of the young girls we met there. Well, they were young women, really. They were sort of 14, 15, 16, to workshops. And they, and Teresa and Claire, the writers, were in those workshops, as were the associate director and the producers and the casting director and her associate. And we workshopped together. So we were kind of the adult group. We described ourselves as the big sisters to them, as the little sisters. And we'd exchange stories about what it's like growing up. We'd do improvisations. We'd brainstorm ideas for characters. And out of that, a group assembled themselves and became friends in this odd, peculiar way, where they became really bonded. Some of them had sort of known each other from school, some of them hadn't. And they formed a group that was sort of irresistible to us. We could just see that we had to cast them as the key group in the film. And lots of the supporting artists were drawn from girls we met going through schools and going through those workshop processes. But that core cast were the ones that came back again and again and just really blossomed in terms of their acting abilities and all they contributed, and showed themselves and generously and boldly showed us how much they could offer to the film and how much they wanted to be part of it. And we were so grateful for that. So they became the key cast.
And I think a key difference, I think, between when it comes to the making of Girlhood and Rocks is, I think Céline had written the film or pretty much nailed down the film before doing the street casting, whereas the cast helped the writer. I mean, that collaborative effort with the plot, is that right? And the scripting as well.
Yeah, and that is unusual. So we didn't even have a story outline or anything when we began the casting process. Which was complicated for financiers because it turned the whole system on its head. We were saying, we want our casting budget before we have anything else. because the idea was if we found the group of girls to build it with, they could come on every step of that journey with us. And then, you know, it would be true to them and they'd be playing roles that they understood, not themselves, but roles that they connected with. So yeah, we did change it up. And it was only about halfway through the workshop process that a storyline, Teresa offered up a storyline that became the central narrative. And then she and Claire built into that from contributions within the team.
Right, I see. And I think it seems as though both you and Céline, with regards to as women directors, you both seem to me to have a very clear sense of your responsibility with regards to representation, as I said, you know, behind the camera, so the crew. So your crew, it was mostly women, wasn't it? And I heard you say, and I really like the expression of see it to be it, as in you wanted the cast members to look behind the camera and see themselves working on the film. So has that been a conscious thing throughout your career, or was that something you thought particularly with Rocks you wanted to make that point?
Well, I thought that I was sort of seeking out women to work with, and but actually I realized when I got to Rocks that I had never met a female cinematographer to work with. And why hadn't I? I'd gone through the normal list, and there are some brilliant male cinematographers out there, as we all know. But for this, it felt so, you know, just obvious that the crew, who are always the storytellers as well as everybody else, you know, there should be a coherence, and that we all should be contributing. And it felt really important that the girls in the cast, as you said, when they looked behind the camera, they saw people that they could recognize, people that they could aspire to be, you know. And so whether it's the makeup designer or the production designer or the costume designer, you know, or the camera team, we had two cameras, an entirely female camera teams, apart from one or two men in some roles. But really, really, it was, we said it's 75%, but it felt like sort of 90% to me of women on set, and some drawn from the communities close to the girls. So yeah, it was a very, very conscious effort. And we put a lot of work into it, you know, because those people don't appear on lists everywhere. And they are there. But, you know, as we know, film hasn't been accessible and film has been male dominated for years and years, and particularly in certain areas like camera and stuff. So we made an effort and it was felt really right. And I think for me, it really enriched. Well, I hope for everybody, it enriched the process.
And do you think that's affected how you will work in the future?
Well, certainly I learned a lot on this film. And I always say that I was the one on set that learned the most. Because, you know, I had this incredible female team and the young women, and they were teaching me so much about their lives, the world they lived in, the world they knew. And it was really enlightening. It was kind of creatively energizing. It was challenging, you know, they were challenging me, I was challenging them. It was kind of trying to work out the best way to work, trying to introduce people who hadn't been on film sets before to the whole culture of filmmaking. But also every step of the way, we were trying to make it bespoke in a way for the project. So, you know, down to things that we learnt from other people who have worked in this way, like Andrea and Ken Loach and a number of other, Shane Meadows and other European directors. So, you know, filming chronologically, because it means you can hold on to the story. And for first time actors, it's really, really helpful to follow things in their order. And we didn't shout action, and we ran two cameras, so it wasn't like they had to hit exact marks and repeat actions each time. So they had a lot of freedom. And I think most crucially, perhaps, we shot in real locations all the time. So we never did a set build. We shot all, you know, everything geographically linked up. I mean, filmmaking usually is this ridiculous puzzle. It's like you've kind of taken a jigsaw puzzle, thrown it on the floor, and then you film each bit in total isolation. You have to imagine all the time how it's going to fit together. And we reduced a lot of that jigsaw puzzle element by just doing it chronologically, which was horribly difficult for the production, because they had to kind of, you know, tie themselves in knots to make that possible for us to go into a school, into a housing estate, out of it again and back into it. But for the storytellers, it was very liberating.
Wow, that's fascinating. And you know, how worth it? Because as you say, to have to make the young cast as comfortable as possible and to really live the story as much as they can. Just to go back to Girlhood, and for people watching this, who may not have seen the film, I don't think it's a spoiler to say that there is a crucial scene which involves Rihanna and diamonds. And yeah, it's spellbinding. There's something really spellbinding about this scene in which four friends sing a Rihanna song. It doesn't sound that interesting, but what is it about that scene that just manages to be so captivating?
Well, she's been very brave in the way she's, I'm talking about the director here, in the way that she's staged it and done it, because it's very sustained. It's the whole track. You're just holding on these girls. There's heightened lighting, which isn't naturalistic. It's quite stylized. The sound is quite stylized. It's not like you're hearing everything going on. So you're really, really focused on them. I did just rewatch the film, but I must just check, because I feel like it's slightly slow motion, and maybe it is. I've sort of gotten into a kind of, I can't think whether that's my projection or whether it is, but maybe, I don't know. But anyway, she definitely, in fact, not just in that scene, but throughout, she's using sound and music in very interesting ways. And she's kind of providing pace, you know. So there's a shot earlier on of the main character, who's called, nicknamed Vic, standing at the kitchen sink in her home. And it's a key moment where she's just picked up a knife, and you can see that she's kind of turning in terms of her approach to life. And then the camera pulls back very, very slowly. And there's this electronic music, very fast paced, that gives you a sense of kind of adrenaline and, you know, but on this very, very slow tracking out shot. It was so not naturalistic at all. And, you know, and the Rihanna Diamonds moment is another of those moments where it's very immersive, and it's cinema at its best. I think the mise-en-scene, the colours, the way it's shot, the use of sound is really, really clever. And it just at that moment captures everything about those young women and enjoyment, actually, in that moment. And apparently she didn't get permission when she shot it. And as any, you know, person filmmaker knows, it's a nightmare getting music permission. So that was a big gamble, but she got it afterwards.
Wow. It just feels so spontaneous, and obviously it won't have been, but as a viewer, it feels there's that sort of the dancing, the lip syncing along. It just feels like she manages to capture this sort of self-expression and self, just being a teenage girl and dancing with your mates, you know, but heightened, as you say. So can you remember when you first watched the film, like where you were, or...
I'm pretty sure. I mean, I'm quite a regular cinema, well, at least pre-COVID, I was a very regular cinema goer when I could. And I'm pretty sure, but I can't absolutely swear that I would have seen it maybe in Brunswick Square at the cinema there. And I would have definitely gone to the cinema, not watched it on DVD. But I remember, I've watched it probably seven times since. I'm a big rewatcher of films, so... So now I'm getting a little bit vague about the very first time, but I remember discovering, you know, her work and just being very, very excited. And I just, you know, I hope that there are many more, well, there are more and more women emerging, and you want more and more women from different walks of life who've got different perspectives. You know, she's interesting. She's a gay woman who looks at gender fluidity in her work. She's just got a, you know, she's got a real approach. She talks about the female gaze. She's very vocal about all that. She stands up for that. I mean, I think that's exciting. And I also feel like I want to be someone who talks about what it's like to be a woman in film. And in fact, what it's like to be, you know, and stands up for anyone who's unrepresented and tries to open the door and wedge open the door for people coming through. Because I think until we get a broader industry, we need to continue to do that.
Very much so. So just one more question for anyone about to watch the film. Is there a particular scene or character or one thing that you would like to tell people just to keep an eye out for if they haven't seen it before and they're watching it for the first time?
Yeah, I mean, it's a rich film, and the central friendships are really sort of beautifully nuanced and done, because it's edgy. You never know whether these friends are going to turn on one another. And I think, you know, watch for the turning points, watch for the moment where our central protagonist makes decisions to, you know, there's one moment where she decides actually she's going to be the gang leader. And it's very subtly done, but she's making those decisions. And it's a really well-crafted script, because it doesn't signpost things. I mean, in some ways it's quite an archetypal story and you sort of know where you're going, but it's subtly done.
Lovely. Well, Sarah Gavron, thank you so much for talking about a film you love. Thank you.
Thank you for having me.